And then also for those of us that sometimes like to take notes and might not be able to during this presentation. So I think I'm already recording it. So again, my name is Rocio Gomez. I am one of the counselors at Cerritos High School. In particular, I'm the counselor for last names D through I. Later tonight, Ms. Kellerman, who is counselor at Cerritos as well, will be joining me and helping me with the chat box. In case you do have questions as I'm speaking, please put them on the chat box. We will be checking that and answering them live if we feel that everybody's having those same questions, or answering them on the chat box in case it's something very personal. You can also message privately if you want to tell me something or Ms. Kellerman something in particular in regards to your student, if you don't want everybody else to be able to read it. So the title of the presentation is Succeeding in High School. So I am going to go over a lot of things, but the main goal is, of course, how to help your new student to Cerritos High succeed, and how vital are the next 4 years into their future. You are muted and your videos are disabled, but you are able to participate through the chat box. Okay, so I like to give you an overview as to what you're gonna expect. I'm gonna go ahead and introduce the counseling department, who we are, and who we serve, and then I will go into Cerritos High School. I know some of you are brand new to our school. Some of you might have other students that are currently at our school that are in other grade levels, or perhaps have students that already graduated. And then I'll go into what universities look for, that holistic approach, and why ninth grade is so important. And then we'll go into graduation as well, and how that may overlap with the A through G requirements, which I will go into as well. And then at the very end, we will do a Q&A. Okay, so these are the Cerritos High School counselors in a Bitmoji format. We got a little bit crazy with the Bitmoji over the summer and put ourselves into this virtual world, right? So we do have 6 school counselors at our school. We have Dr. Gutierrez, who works with students A through C, myself with students D through I, Mr. Beck, who has 2 caseloads. His first caseload is last name J through K. Oh, the sound level is really low. If you're able to hear me, I hope you can put on there if it sounds better. And if all of you can hear me, please put that on there as well. But thanks for letting me know. Ms. Kellerman, who's the counselor for last names L through O, and Ms. Marbray, who's the counselor for last names P through S, and then Mr. Beck, again, who is overseeing last names T through Z. Now, the best way to get a hold of us is via email, especially right now because of the virtual format that we're in. If you do have questions, feel free to reach us. Our emails are basically our first name, period, last name at abcusd.us, or you can also go on to our Cerritos High website and find our email through there. Hopefully at this point you are able to see who your counselor is, and you might have already made contact with one of us at some point, or your student. Thank you so much for letting me know that you can hear me. That's great to know. Okay, so what do we do in the counseling world? So our entire job is to support your student in all kinds of ways, the academic and the social emotional. So your student might need information, might need guidance, might need a letter of recommendation, or they might just need to talk to somebody that's not there to judge us. So that's where we come in. So our role is to be your student's advocate, to support them every step of the way, in anything and everything. Now, there is a big caseload that we all follow, or we all have. So a lot of the information that's basic, we posted on our website. Now, we did create a counseling website that has a lot of information on college, on career, on our weekly events, resources, tutoring information, how to deal with difficult situations, community resources, like if your family doesn't have food or needs rent assistance, we have a list of things and resources for everybody. So if you have not bookmarked our website, I strongly encourage you that at the end of this presentation, you are able to go on there and bookmark it, have your student bookmark it as well. You can find our website by going to cerritoshs.us, clicking on academics, and then clicking on counseling. It's going to redirect you to our Google site that has all of that information. We also have it in our signatures, so if we've ever emailed you, you're also able to click on that signature and be redirected to our website. Okay. I'm glad you can hear me, and it was just one person. Again, if you have any questions, that's what we're there for. Your student has questions, you have questions, feel free to email us. We do our best to get back to you. We do have about 450 students on our caseload, so you know, don't expect an immediate response, but we will do our absolute best. Now, it is very important that you go onto your Aries account if you have not already done that, and make sure that the email that's in your Aries account is accurate, and it is one that you check, because we do all of our communication via email through that email, whatever is on Aries. A lot of times we get bounce backs and we're not able to contact you and have you updated. So if you could do that for us, that would be very, very helpful. We also utilize a tool on Aries called Communications, where we send out a lot of information when we have an event like tonight, or we have a university visiting us, or we have any announcement that we want you to be aware of. So if you could, please go to Aries later today or tomorrow and just make sure that your email is accurate. There's also a way to check your notifications. So some parents might say, Cerritos sends too many emails, I'm going to disable it, and then you don't hear from us. So it's important that you go on there and you check what you want us, or what kind of information you want to receive from us. And then again, I know I've said it many times, but please bookmark our counseling site. Every week we put, or every day that we can, we put weekly announcements as to everything that's coming up next week, counseling related, scholarship related, program related, things like that, that are beneficial to our students. We also have an Instagram account that we recently created as a way to hopefully communicate with more students. So if you go to Instagram, or if your student has an Instagram, it's CHS Dawn's Counseling. We also have the link on all of our signatures, so you're able to also redirect through Instagram. And you can also view the Instagram page without having an Instagram account, as long as you go to Instagram.com and then / CHS Dawn's Counseling. So basically, you know, try to stay communicated with us, because we are part of the team, your students' team. We all have the same goals. Your goal, our goal, your students' goal is to reach graduation, get a diploma, and further their goals, whether that's a two-year college, four-year university, military, whatever it is. So we're all on the same page. Okay, so aside from the counselors, of course, we have the Cerritos family, right? All of us are here to support your student. I know a lot of you might be very new to Cerritos High, so I want to quickly go over this. This PowerPoint and this video will be available, so you'll be able to refer back if you need to see who all these individuals are. So, of course, right now with this online world, we have two individuals that are overseeing all of the technology needs. So if your student has a Chromebook that they're borrowing from school and they're having an issue with it, or just their own laptop, these two individuals, Ms. Marcroft and Mr. Meyer, are able to support your student. If your student does need a Chromebook or a hotspot, they're able to get that from the library, and I'll go into who they are. If your student is absent, typically we would have you write a note and have your student bring it to campus. Of course, we can't do that now. So we do have an online Google form that your student is able to fill out, or yourself ideally, where you indicate why your student was out, whether it was illness or something else. There is an area where you can attach a note. So if your student went to the dentist or orthodontist or whatever it was, you can upload that note, and then our attendance secretary will print it, put it in the file. So it's very, very important that you do this whenever your student is absent, because if your student is absent for a excused absence, then a teacher is able to give them extra time to do an assignment. If it's unexcused, or we just don't know, or if their student was truant, then the teacher does not do that. So very important that if your student is out, that you let the attendance office know through the Google form. Now, to find that, you can go to our CerritosHS.us website and then click on attendance. It'll redirect you to that Google form. You can also email her, but I think she would prefer the Google form. Her email is listed here. If you have questions about assignments, you contact the teacher. Ideally, your student will contact the teacher, but if you would like to speak with them, you can also do that. Now, with the library, if your student needs a Chromebook, or they already have a Chromebook from us, but it's not working too well, they're able to do their best to troubleshoot. There's also IT through the district, so either one of them can help you. If you need a hotspot, you would go to the library and obtain that. ideally you would go through us first so we can put you on a list, make sure that it's available for you. And of course, books. Students occasionally will have to pick up books throughout the year because of English class or something in one of their classes. So all of that is done through the library. We also count with an amazing school nurse, Teresa Peterson. So if you have any questions medical related, or you feel like she needs to know about a condition that your student has that we're not aware of, she would be definitely the best person to reach out to. If your student is planning to do spring sports, we do have a whole process with athletics and a clearance, and this is the secretary that oversees that area. And then we do count with two mental health providers at our school, basically school social workers that are able to provide therapy to students. They do have a Google Classroom that students have been receiving emails to join. They have a lot of resources on their tips, how to manage stress, how to practice deep breathing, how to organize themselves, how to decrease anxiety, things like that. So I strongly encourage that you ask your student, have you joined the mental health Google Classroom yet? You haven't? Do you know how to get to it? They might say no. Then you can reach out to us and we can definitely provide you with that. You can also go onto the Cerritos High website, and it is also linked under there under mental health support. And then lastly, I want to talk about lunch. We do provide lunch with our district. So if your student is getting free reduced lunch, there are locations at the district where students can pick up lunches or foods. But I also recommend applying to free reduced lunch because it helps with fees for the AP exams, for SATs and ACTs and waivers, things like that. I know your student is not currently in an AP class this year, but they will maybe be in it next year. So it'd be important that you get used to filling out this application. It's very simple. You go on the website, schoollunchapp.com, fill it up, and then the district will let you know if you qualified. And if you didn't, it's okay. You gave it a shot and you can try again next year or not. That's definitely up to you. But I strongly recommend that you should apply every year, ideally, so you see where you stand with free reduced lunch. Okay. Okay, so if you have any questions about the counseling team or the Cerritos family, feel free to put it in the chat box. Ms. Kellerman will be able to answer questions, or myself, regarding your questions. Alrighty, so I want to go into what universities look for. Now, this is what we call the holistic approach, and the reason we put it in a circle is because we want students and families to know that universities are looking at the whole picture, right? They're looking at what every single student is doing in the 4 years that they're in their high school. Now, currently, things are a little bit different because of COVID. So this is a circle or holistic approach that is more reflecting the pre-COVID era, and it wouldn't apply to current seniors, some juniors. But for your student, it will apply because we are staying positive and hoping that by the time your freshman is a junior and a senior, things are a lot better pandemic-wise. So it's really important that your student has a strong GPA. So what is a strong GPA? So we're looking at a 3.0 or higher, which is basically a B average. Now, with ninth grade, we know, and universities know, that ninth grade is challenging. Of course, your student is transitioning from middle school into a bigger setting with stricter teachers, you know, a little different competition than middle school had. And of course, we're in a pandemic. So it makes it more challenging for your student, but they're still looking at that GPA. They're still hoping that your student's GPA is as strong as possible. Now, what the universities are gonna do, the UCs and the Cal States, they will look at ninth grade, and we don't necessarily promote all of this to your student because we want them to do their best, but they will look at ninth grade. They will make sure that your student receives C's or higher, and they will kind of leave it there. But for the private schools, they will look at ninth grade and they will count it in the GPA. So the UC and the CSU system will utilize 10th and 11th grade into the GPA. They will glance at ninth grade, make sure it looked good, but they will not count it in the GPA. The reason they do this is because historically, we know that ninth graders will struggle transitioning from the middle school into the high school. It's not that the curriculum is difficult or challenging, it's just that adjustment into that high school setting. Schools like our school, which is pretty big compared to their middle school and pretty demanding and pretty competitive. So it is a little bit of an adjustment. So they look at 10th grade, 11th grade and count that into the GPA. And that's what we call the UCCSU GPA. Now, if your student is dreaming of going to a private school and has been talking about that since they were little, then ninth grade is crucial because that is going to be part of the GPA. So that's the reason we don't promote that to students. We usually promote it 10th grade when we see that ninth grade was not you know, as high as it could be, but we want them to work their hardest in ninth grade. But if they didn't perform the way that we were hoping for, then in 10th grade, we reassure them, hey, you know, don't stress. You did your best 10th grade, though. 11th grade, that's when you're going to have to do your absolute best for that GPA. So strong GPA, 3.0 or higher. Okay, now the next big thing that universities look for is the SAT, ACT score. So right now for the current senior, incoming junior, they're looking at what's called test optional, and they're looking at test blind. So test optional means if your student took the SAT, ACT, they can post it onto their application. If they didn't, no worries. They're not going to be penalized for it. Now test blind means they're not even asking for it. So for the current junior, we don't know exactly what universities are going to be following test optional, test blind, or requesting the SAT, ACT, which is why for the current freshman and current sophomore, we're recommending that they prepare for the SAT, ACT. Now, I will be going over a little later as to how that is done. And I will also go into a little more detail as to what community service does and why it's important. And then I will be going over it very much in detail and hopefully not putting you to sleep on the A through G requirements and graduation requirements. And then I will also go briefly into honors awards and personal statement. I did want to touch base on APs. So at our high school, ninth grade students are not in AP classes, but chances are your student is maybe in an honors class, English, maybe science, maybe math, maybe something different. But we are encouraging that starting sophomore year, your student, if they are prepared, they take an AP class and they start with one class. Typically it's world history. Some students will have AP computer science, but usually one is what we recommend, and then we ask students to build on that. So we say by your junior year, you should have two. If you really want to push yourself, do three, and then senior year, do three, maybe four. Now, we want students to remember that universities are looking at the whole picture. So if your student is taking a lot of AP classes but not doing service, not being involved, and I'll go over into all of that a little bit later, but if they're not fulfilling all these areas of this holistic approach, then that application is going to lack. We also don't want to overwhelm your student. We need a good balance. We need them to do basic things like eat and sleep. A lot of students will end up sacrificing that. Now, if your student is very organized, not a procrastinator, and still manages schoolwork and sleep and those basic needs, then, you know, they can definitely take APs, as many as they would like. But we usually say start with one, do two, and then three, build on it. Now, we do know that competition is taking a lot of APs, but at the same time, we're looking at that holistic approach, right? We want your students to have a little bit of everything and fulfill that pizza pie. If you have questions, go ahead and place them in the chat. How about if the ninth grader is doing well, will it be useless? No. So like I said, ninth grade is important because you're building on it. If your student is performing well, they will be fully ready for 10th grade, 11th grade, and so forth, right? It builds on what you've learned. But if your student is applying to a private school, then yes, it's crucial because it's part of the GPA. The UC and the CSU is only going to count GPA for 10th and 11th grade. So no, ninth grade is extremely important in so many ways. Do quarter grades affect your GPA? No, that's a great question. So semester grades are the ones that are part of the transcript that go into the GPA. And semester for us ends in January, end of January, and then early June is our second semester. Quarter grades are more of an FYI, just to let you know where you're at, right in the middle. So it gives us a good understanding if we need to approach your student and say, hey, you know, let's figure out some tutoring, let's figure out some next steps, let's troubleshoot this. So you end the semester in a strong position, C or higher. Okay, so these are the A through G requirements. Hopefully you don't fall asleep during this portion, but this is super important. Once your student is on our campus, they will see this poster everywhere they go. We want to really like implant that in their brains. Now, we as a counseling team do a pretty good job in making sure that all students are fulfilling A through G requirements. Every year, we will meet with your student to make sure that they are. And that, of course, you know, your student should also be very familiar with A through G to make sure that we are on the same page. But 100% of our students know the A through G requirements and understand where they stand with the A through G. So very simple. and hopefully I don't put you to sleep. Students need 2 years of history. Now your student will begin history next year with world history, and then they will do US history their junior year. Now senior year, they will take government and economics. Those are state requirements. They will do English every year. Of course, you know, there's the honors English, and then there's AP English that we offer junior and senior year. Now, with mathematics, the university requires that students do 3 years, and they're basically labeled as Integrated Math 1, Integrated Math 2, and Integrated Math 3. Now, some students might be an accelerated, same thing, you know, that's still the same path where they're doing level 1, 2, and level 3. Now, the universities recommend that students do a fourth year. Now, it's not a requirement, but it's a recommendation. So for all of our students, I would say about 98% of students will end up doing that fourth year of math. Even if a student's not going to major in anything STEM related later on, we know that math is crucial. We know that math is important. We also know that they're going to have to take math for general ed at the university. So might as well continue that math flow. So we recommend those 4 years of math. Now with the science, the university requires 2 years. So it's 1 year, which is biology, which is what your student is currently in. And then next year, it'll be chemistry. Students can do physical or physics instead of chemistry if they wanted to. However, it's typically bio and chem. Now the university recommends a third year of that science, and that can be a physics class, that can be an AP, AP bio, AP chem, AP environmental, or that can be advanced topics in biology, marine biology. So we offer a variety of different sciences that can fulfill this area. Now, 2 years required, 3 years recommended. Now, if your student says, you know, I barely got through chemistry, there's no way I'm going to do a third year of a science, this is not my field, I'm not even interested in that, that's okay. As long as your student does an extra year of something else, which anything that I will talk about in the next few seconds, then their application will be full, and it will be okay if they didn't take that extra year of science. Now, if your student is going to major in anything science, tech, engineering, or math, then we're recommending a fourth year of a science. The reason we say that is we are constantly seeing the competition taking 4 years of science. So we want your student to be competitive. And if that's the field they're going into, then science will be something they enjoy, and it won't be a task for them. So 3 years recommended, but if your student doesn't want to do that, that's okay. 2 years is fine. The fourth year, if they're going to be majoring in science, tech, engineering, or math. And then we have foreign language. The university requires 2 years of the same language. Now, they do recommend a third year, and we strongly recommend a fourth year. So your student does a fourth year, they get what's called the seal of biliteracy. And this is a great, great thing because it's a seal that goes onto their diploma that indicates they're bilingual or biliterate. And then we also give them a medal to wear at graduation. But I think the best part is that your student can go to an interview and say, I am certified as bilingual biliterate by the state because I took 4 years of Korean or 4 years of Spanish or Japanese or French or whatever area that they're currently in. So I strongly recommend that your student fulfills the 4 years. However, if, you know, like the science example, they say, I'm going to do the 2 years because I cannot do another year of this language, then that's okay, as long as they're doing that extra year of the science or they're doing something extra. Now, the university does require 1 year of an art. At Cerritos High, we count with a lot of arts. We have ceramics, we have art, we have drama, we have graphic design, we have film and video production, etc. So there's a lot of different options. Now, if your student is currently in a pathway, let's say computer science or engineering or the medical pathway, and as we plan their four-year plan, which your student, your freshman and the counselor will be planning in December, if your student starts to notice, wait, there's no space for me to take all these classes, I'm already taking six classes, sometimes even seven, adding that zero period or that extra class, how am I going to fulfill an art? This is where we recommend that students fulfill it through the community college. Now, that's a great opportunity because you're getting college credit and high school credit. Your student gives us a transcript, we put it in their transcript, they get credits for us. And when they get to their university, they're done with their art. So I strongly recommend this. We usually have a little workshop that we discuss the process to get into dual enrollment roughly around May, so students are able to get an art class. I strongly, strongly recommend that you have your student fulfill this. There are a lot of online classes. Even, you know, pre-pandemic, we had a lot of online classes that students were taking advantage of. So I strongly recommend that even if your student takes an art with us, they take advantage of community college in general because classes are free for high school students. All you have to pay for is a 20 to 20 $25 fee. It's a student fee, and of course the book or any materials that come with it. But it's a nice investment into the future because it's going to save you from taking that class later on, or your student taking it later on, and also not having to pay that large fee for the class. Now, the last one is called the college prep elective. So this is basically an extra year of anything else. So an extra year of math, an extra year of the science, or the extra year of foreign language, or more than that. Or maybe your student really likes a specific art and they fulfill level 1, 2, and 3. So that will count as the G, the college prep. So when your student is applying to the university will see how many A through Gs your student took. And then they will count them up and they'll say, okay, student took 35 out of the 40 that the school offers. That's pretty good. You know, the student is pretty competitive. So the more A through Gs your student takes, the better they are. Now, students have to get C's or better to be eligible for universities. If your student does happen to get a D or an F, they do have to retake this class, and I'll go over that in a little bit. And then, of course, you know, ACT, SAT for your student will be part of the college admission process as we discussed. Now, I want to go over the A through G requirements versus the graduation requirements, where they overlap and where they're very different. But I'll go ahead and pause to see if there's any questions. Ms. Kellerman, do you know, do you have any questions that we should answer for the whole group? Okay, let me add Ms. Kellerman to be a panelist. Okay. With college credits, will my student be considered a freshman in college? Will it affect any scholarship? Oh, this is a great question. So if your student is taking dual enrollment or college courses and getting credits, then your student will be definitely advanced or ahead of students that are going into the college or the university with 0 units. So then your student will be able to enroll into classes before that student with 0 units. So there's other advantages to it besides the dual enrollment. How does it affect scholarships? It doesn't. Your student is still able to apply to scholarships. I would probably think it helps better. Okay, so oops. All right, so high school graduation versus A through G. So for graduation, we also require 4 years of English, which is what the A through G requires. With the social science, kind of went over that already. With the math, we're looking at those 30 credits or 3 years for A through G and for graduation. For sciences, we're looking at the same things, life science, physical science, so bio and chem. Now, the difference though is that we ask for 2 years of PE. So this is a state requirement. Now, PE is fulfilled through the PE class, through a sport, or through the marching band. So if your student, which all of your students are in one of those three, then they will be getting their PE credits. Now they do have to take it for 2 years. If your student wants to do a third year, fourth year of a sport or a band or whatnot, then that's okay. But for graduation, we're looking at 2 years for PE. Now, we do have a state requirement that students have to fulfill health, and health is only 1 semester. Some of your students are currently in futures and health, and that will fulfill that area. And then some of your students are not in it at all, and that's okay. So don't stress. I would say about maybe 60% of our students have not taken the health class through the class itself and will end up doing it online. So what we have is a program called Edmentum, which we utilize for credit recovery, but we also utilize for students to fulfill health. Your student will be signing up for that, usually for junior, senior year to fulfill health. And then of course we have summer school, and that's where I strongly recommend students fulfill their health requirement through summer school. It's very simple. Roughly around the time that your student and the counselor will meet to discuss what classes they want next year is when we will say, hey, you haven't fulfilled health. Do you want to take care of it this summer, or do you want to postpone it? It's okay to postpone it. So if your student says, no, I'd rather get it over with, then even better. One less thing for us to worry about. Otherwise, we'll keep bringing it up. So don't stress about it. The counselor will work with your student to fulfill the health requirements. Now, foreign language, with the A through Gs, they require 2 years of the foreign language. For graduation, we require either 1 year of a foreign language or 1 year of an art. Chances are that your freshman is currently enrolled in a foreign language or maybe a fine art. So they're already fulfilling that by the end of freshman year. And then for graduation, we ask for 75 credits. So what does that look like? That looks like that third year or fourth year of math, that third year of science, extra sport if they wanted to, maybe more foreign language, maybe a couple of fine arts, or maybe other electives that we offer on our campus. So in total, your student has to have 230 credits by the end of senior year to receive their diploma. So basically in high school, every class that your student is taking is worth 5 credits per semester. So if your student is currently taking 6 classes, at the end of the semester, they will have 30 credits. At the end of this year, they will have 60 credits. So you get the point. So your student will be okay for graduation as long as your student is getting D's or higher. So for universities, we want, you know, ideally B's or higher, but C's are okay. For graduation, we're looking at D's or higher. If your student does get an F, they do have to retake the course. All right. Okay, so I went a little bit into the GPA a little earlier on. Students should have a 3.0 or higher. Now, I did want to go over CSU eligibility index. This is something we bring up mainly to the seniors, but I do want to plant this seed for the freshman families. Is Cal State Long Beach is our closest Cal State. So because of that, they have a formula that they utilize for the students in their area, which means that when students are seniors and they're looking at how to categorize their universities, Cal State Long Beach tends to be a safety school, as long as their GPA is a 3.0. Now, here and there, if the student's GPA is a little lower, but their SAT, ACT score is high, then it kind of balances out and they meet the requirements. So just know that Cal State Long Beach is our local school and that your student will have a pretty high probability of getting into that campus. Now, just to recap, the UCCSU will utilize 10th and 11th grade to determine their GPA, but they will look at 9th grade. So they are looking to make sure 9th grade had C's or better. And then of course the private school is going to analyze that 9th grade included in the GPA. So 9th grade is extremely important. Now for retakes, if your student gets a D or an F, they will have to retake their course either via Edmentum, which is a credit recovery course that we offer. Usually we utilize this Edmentum program for students junior, senior year when we're closer to graduation. So if your freshman doesn't do well this year, sophomore year, they will not be able to do Edmentum. We rely on summer school. So if at the end of the semester, which is end of January, your student did fail a class or received a D and you know that your student wants to go to a four-year university, we're going to recommend summer school. So it's important that you kind of look over those grades before you schedule any vacations, because our summer school does start about a week after we end the school year and it runs for about 6 to 7 weeks. So if you do want to schedule a vacation, I would definitely recommend early August. All right. Okay, so SAT, ACT, I went a little bit over into what that means. Now, the SAT is designed to assess the academic readiness for college in two specific areas, the math area and then the reading and writing area. Now, the ACT covers the same areas, except it has a little hint of science. Now, we in the counseling department, we recommend that students take both the SAT and ACT. Now, don't stress, your student will not be recommended to do this until their junior year. So we have plenty of time to prepare for that, to study for that, and I'll go over how we can do that. But we recommend that students do both because we see that some students will do really well on one and completely differently on the other one. So if we can expose them to both their junior year and see which one they liked better or did better on, have them retake that one the next year, or basically senior year in the fall. So it's recommended that they try out both. The ACT is Common Core language. Your student is being taught Common Core right now, so it'll be great for them to be exposed to that. Now for the SAT, we tend to expose them a little bit more into that through the PSAT, which we typically do 10th grade year. And then of course there's other things that are out there. Now, how does your student prepare for this? There's a couple of things. There are apps that your student can download onto their smart device. If your student does not have a smartphone, that's okay. They have access to the internet, so they can look up on the internet different websites on how to prepare for the SAT. Now, I recommend that if your student does have a smartphone and they add the app, you ask your student, devote yourself 5 minutes a day to just looking at a question for the SAT and a question for the ACT. It might not even take 5 minutes, but I think it's a really good opportunity for them to get a little used to what those questions look like, what those options look like when they take the testing. Now there is something called SAT subject. SAT subject is specifically for STEM majors. Now universities don't require it, but they do recommend it. It just showcases how your student is doing in math, and in science. So I strongly recommend that your student's junior year, they look into SAT subject. And when we meet with them, we start asking them, what major are you thinking about? And once they say a STEM major, then we say, hey, you might want to look into SAT subject if you're applying to the UCs or the private universities. Cal States, they're not too into the SAT subject. So if your student is already interested in only Cal States, then no need to worry on the SAT subject. But we will guide your student when that time comes. I just want to plant that seed in your mind. Okay, so another way for students to prepare for the SAT is through Khan Academy. Now, your student is familiar with Khan Academy because the math teachers are usually having your student go into Khan Academy, look at videos, and so forth. Now, Khan Academy partnered with the College Board to create a study system because they found that students were going to boot camps and paying thousands of dollars and not really improving their score. And it's, you know, quite unfair when we're having students save for college to have them pay for something so early on. So what they created is a study guide. So students are able to go in there. If they are to devote 10 hours, just 10 hours in their entire life, the College Board has data that shows that their score will improve by 100 points, which in SAT world is a lot of points. So if your student can devote anywhere between 20 minutes a week to Khan Academy, it's definitely going to go a long way. Or they can do the apps, whatever is easier, more convenient for them. I think it's never too early to prepare for this, but I'm also not saying have them, you know, glued to a desk learning the SAT material or ACT material already. No, just get them exposed to it. The teachers will be giving them a lot of that information through their instruction learning anyway, so it'll just be, you know, second nature when they start seeing these questions. Now, there's also books that you can purchase, study guides by Princeton Review and by other companies, or you can check them out at a library and just have a notebook and have your student do it. So your student knows what works best for them, if they like tangible things or if they like technology instead. Now, of course, you know, universities, more and more, we've seen that they're thinking about test blind. For some of them, it's not certain what they're going to do for the class of 2022. So I would assume that class of 24 is also up in the air. So when that time comes, junior year, we'll have your student go onto that website for those universities they're thinking about to see if they are recommended to take the SAT, ACT, or if the university is not considering it at all. All right. Okay, community service. So we know that right now things are a little bit more challenging because of the pandemic, but there's still ways for students to do service. Now, when a student applies to a university the fall of senior year, there will be a section that's talking about community service, and students will be asked, where did you volunteer? What did you do? How many hours did you do it? How many weeks did you do it? How many years did you do it? Now, when your student is a senior, they will not remember freshman year, which is why it's important that you pay attention and that you also take notes. Now, what we recommend for the freshmen is to start a Google Doc where they go in and they put in, you know, wrote letters to senior citizens, helped promote a nonprofit on social media, tutored a student at Cerritos High School via Our Power, whatever the case is, that they keep a log of it. We do have a volunteer log on our Cerritos High website if that's something they'd rather utilize instead of a Google Doc. But the idea is to log it, to keep track, because when your student is applying a senior year, they will not remember all these things they did. You might, because you'll remember I, you know, drove you to the post office to drop off those letters, or, you know, I helped you with whatever it was. So it is important that they log it in. Now, universities like students that are consistent, that are committed. Now, it doesn't mean that your students should volunteer in a multitude of places or with a variety of activities. They can stick to one thing, and that's going to look just as good because universities do like that consistency and that commitment. But if your student wants to try different activities, different events, or platforms, then that's okay too. But you know, if they want to stick to one place and give all their hours, that's going to look better. Now, where can they volunteer? Local libraries, I know that's limited right now. Churches, being involved in the youth group, tutoring other students, summer programs. Now, during COVID, of course, you know, we want your student to be safe, but there are a multitude of ways that people can volunteer from home. So that can be writing those cards to the senior citizens or hosting a food drive. A lot of teenagers we know are very savvy with their phones and social media. If they can help a nonprofit get more followers or maybe create a marketing thing or a flyer for their events or whatever the case is. So there are ways to volunteer safely from home. Now there is a website that I really like called Volunteer Match. Students are able to go on there and indicate where they live and then different opportunities will pop up in their area or nationally. If your student is mailing something across the state, then that's okay too. Now, occasionally a student might not be able to volunteer, whether it's because of COVID or maybe they have to babysit or maybe they have to have a job to support the family or whatever the case is. There is an area on the application that will be called additional comments. And your student goes in there and they indicate, you know, I would have loved to volunteer. However, I had responsibilities in my household and I was unable to because of XYZ. So don't feel like if your student is unable to fulfill community service, their application is going to lack. No, as long as they explain why that didn't happen. Okay, extracurricular. So extracurricular is the other part of the holistic approach. So what does that even look like? So that looks like on-campus activities, meaning our sports, our associated student body, our band, or the clubs. Now, our clubs right now are meeting online, and a lot of them have been posting their information on social media and on CHTV. So if your student does not have social media, they can see when a club is meeting through CHTV, which is our, I guess you could call it like television program. And we have students view that during the homeroom. So every day during homeroom, students are able to see it. Now, if your student does not have a homeroom first, the second or third, and it just so happens to land on that day, they're able to go on to our CHTV news channel on YouTube and be able to view those announcements. So your student is able to keep track of when clubs are meeting. Once your student is attending a club, then there's an email list and students are able to keep up with those meeting dates. But I strongly recommend that your student join a club. It's never too late to join a club. Definitely there's still time. You know, we just started the school year. So we do promote our clubs on CHTV and then on social media. And there's a list of them on our Cerritos High website. If you wanted to see what clubs we offer, there's cultural, there's academic, and their service ones as well. Off campus, what does extracurricular look like? That looks like outside sports, cultural groups, organization, and church. You know, anything that's outside of school that is not leisure is an extracurricular. Now, leadership is extremely important. So if your student is in a club or in a sport, then the university wants to see that that student becomes a leader at a point. So maybe this year they're a member of the club, but maybe by junior year, they become a position in the club. They become maybe secretary or treasurer. And then by senior year, they're running the club, they're president, they're co-chair. So the universities want to see that growth, that leadership. Now, summers are very important, not just because we want your student to relax because they just had six classes and it was intense, but because universities do want to see what a student does with that summertime. Now, that doesn't mean that your student should not go to the beach and then, you know, just be working on impressing a university, but they should balance that. So what does a summer look like? Potentially your student taking a community college class, doing some community service, maintaining involvement in the clubs. Clubs sometimes do a lot of summer work. The band will practice in the summer. So just being involved over the summer is important. It doesn't have to be the whole summer. It can just be a couple hours that they devote, or one class that they're in, or one program that they partake in. So, you know, just important. Now, I do recommend that Google Form or Google Doc, where the student is inputting all this information that they've completed, right? So I'm in Boy Scouts and I devote, you know, 10 hours a week to this program, or Girl Scouts, or whatever the case is. But it's important to log it, because that senior year is gonna come faster than we think. And then the student's not gonna remember what they did freshman year. They might have an idea, but they might not remember exactly what they did. Now, the university is also going to ask about honors and awards. They will ask what award they received, why they received it, and when they received it. So that Google Doc will come in handy if there's an area where a student can put in, these are the honors and these are the awards that I received my freshman year, my sophomore year, junior, et cetera. And this is why I received it. So it can be athletic, it can be academic. Now, Cerritos High, at the end of the year, we have an event called the Premio de Oro, and it's basically a teacher who will select a student per period that is an outstanding student, and then they will recommend them to get this award, and then we have an assembly for it. Your student will get a certificate. So these are the type of things that will go on that college application under honors and awards, or it can be something that they receive through their sport as well. So what I recommend for you as a parent, ideally your student's doing the Google Doc, but you're collecting them. So as they get those awards, you put them in a binder safely. So when fall semester of senior year comes up and they're working on college apps, you pull them out and you say, hey, just cross-reference with your Google Doc just to make sure all those honors and awards are being noted on this college application. Okay. Now, the last portion of the college admission process is the personal insight questions or the personal statement. So the UC system will call it personal insight. The students will get 8 options and they will choose 4 of them to write about. It can be anything from your favorite subject to a challenge to something you want them to know about you, to anything really. And then there's the Common App, which is private schools that will utilize the personal statement. They will give them a couple of options and they will select one and write a full-blown essay on this. So personal statement means very personal. Now we do have workshops that we have students partake in senior year, and teachers, English teachers, will do a really good job walking students through the prompts and how to answer these questions. But the reason I bring this up now is because during the next few years, and especially right now in the current situation we're in, there is difficult moments that your student may experience. They might be very anxious right now or frustrated, or they might be having a difficult time adjusting to this online format or a brand new school. And there's a lot of emotions that your student is feeling. So, you know, throughout life, we do experience difficult moments, losses, moves, changes, breakups, friendship changes, things like that. So what I recommend students is if they have a moment that's difficult, that's challenging, that they open up that Google Doc and they start writing about it. The reason I recommend that, you know, aside from journaling being very healthy, it's a way for the student to refer back senior year to that challenge and utilize that same language. So when they're writing that personal statement, personal insight, the emotions are flowing and it's not just a memory and something they remember, but rather having very explicit language as to what they felt the moment they were feeling it. So something that I recommend that students do, but you don't have to do that nor recommend your student do that. Now in the other, when your student applies to private universities through the Common App, they will be asked to get letters of recommendation. Typically it's 2 letters from 2 teachers and 1 from the counselor. So it's important that your student builds a good relationship with their teachers, especially those that are within their field. So if your student is interested in computer science, they build a relationship with the teacher, engineering with the teacher, math with that teacher, and so forth. Now it's important that they build a relationship with the counselor as well, because when it comes down to writing that letter of rec, it's a lot easier for us to write one for somebody that we've communicated with often, that we've gotten to know over the years, versus a student that we saw here and there and the times that we pulled them in. So I would encourage your student at the end of this presentation that you reach out and say, hey, do you know who your counselor is? Yes or no? Have you ever reached out? Do you have any questions you want to ask them? It's a little hard for us to build a relationship right now because of the situation we're in. We can't just call them into our office, but we can certainly answer emails. We can certainly set up a Google Meet, things like that. So I strongly recommend that your student definitely knows who the counselor is and how to get a hold of them, and that they can reach out if they have questions. Now for some majors, students will have to prepare a portfolio. For art majors, definitely they will need a portfolio. Film majors, they will need videos and recordings. So it's important that if that's the field they're going into, they start preparing that portfolio. Alrighty. Okay. Moving forward with tutoring. So as we've talked about, 9th grade is definitely a challenge. We add on the pandemic and the online format, it makes it a little bit more challenging. So we want to make sure that students have access to tutoring programs. Now, at the end of each day, except for Wednesdays, teachers have what's called a support block. And it's basically a 30-minute period, sometimes more depending on the teacher, where students can go in and ask their teacher a question. Hey, you know, I didn't understand this prompt. What did you want us to do here? Or, hey, I already did this, but I'm not sure if this is long enough, or is it too short? What do you recommend? So think of it as office hours, right? So students are able to go in there and ask for support, ask for help. So if your student is currently struggling in a class, then we recommend, you know, have you gone to support block? Have you talked to your teacher? Have you reached out? Now we also count with a great program called Our Power. During the school year, what we do with Our Power is we open it up after school 3 days a week. Students come in for help and they're matched with either a student that's an expert in that area, usually a senior or a junior tutoring a younger student, or it's sometimes a teacher that is in there supporting the student. So with the online format, it looks a little different. Students go onto their website and they can submit a question and it gets responded. So if it's a math question, they can put a math problem. If they're not sure what a prompt for English class is asking, they can type that in and then the tutor will get back to them. Now on our website for Cerritos High Counseling, we have an area under resources called tutoring, where students can click on it and it'll give them a list of other tutoring formats. Besides the HourPower, there's others that we definitely recommend that are outside of campus, not affiliated with us, but also great programs that are offered after school. Now, definitely the best person to ask for help is always the teacher. So if your student is struggling, ask them, have you gone to support block? Have you reached out to the teacher? If the answer is yes, I've done all of it. Have you talked to your counselor? Let's figure this out. Let's troubleshoot. Let's make sure that your grades are where they're at and that you're getting all the resources, all the support that you need to succeed. Okay, so that was the end of the presentation. If you do have questions, please post them onto the chat box and then we will read them out loud and answer them. My email is located here if you have a question for me. Again, all the counselors have the same email. It'll be first name period last name at abcusd.us, and we do our best to get back to you in a promptly manner. If you have any questions, please post them on there. We will definitely answer them. And if you don't, then you're free to go. Thank you so much for joining us. We know it's late, we know it's dinner time, we know there's a game going on, but we appreciate your interest in learning about our department, our school, and how we can support you and your student to reach their goals by the end of their high school career. And then a big thank you to Ms. Kellerman, who's been managing that chat box as well. You're very welcome. Thank you so much for joining us. And if you have questions or would like clarification, definitely place it in the chat box. How can we get extra math work for our students? I'm not sure what you mean by extra math work. If you're looking for maybe different math things for your student to utilize, I would definitely recommend Khan Academy because that will prepare them for the SAT and also goes into different sectors of math.
I will piggyback on that and just say to reach out to your child's teacher because maybe they can recommend some other content or other, you know, their areas that they can get extra practice on and recommend some sites.
Yes, this recording along with all of the other grade level presentations will be on our Cerritos High Counseling website under resources and then parents. Yes, so again, this presentation was recorded and it'll be available on our Cerritos High Counseling website under parents and also under resources. You're very welcome. Thank you for joining us.
I also want to add for those of you still here that it's never too early to check our senior guidebook that we created. There is some specific stuff on there for seniors regarding application help, but it's a good idea to familiarize yourself with the guidebook that we put together. It is on our counseling website along with so many other wonderful resources. So we encourage you guys to please become familiar with our site and all the resources there for you.
Should we be looking at the weekly UC videos? I'm not too sure what you mean by the UC videos. We do have, there are links on the ABCUSD website, the Counselor Connection, that has a lot of different videos that they've put together from different high schools in our district. It's never too early to learn about it. However, a lot of that information will not necessarily apply to your student class of 24 because things might be changing, but the overall gist of it will apply, but not all those specifics. So if you're still here with us, feel free to add a question onto the chat box if you have any questions or doubts about our high school or about counseling in general. Thank you for your positive comments as well. So the question is, what affects the GPA? So at Cerritos, we have everything being part of the GPA, every course except for PE or sports, that won't go into the GPA. So it's all the academics. And then for the UCCSU, they're looking at 10th and 11th grade in particular. Private schools are gonna look at 9th, 10th, and 11th. By the end of graduation or towards graduation, we will have an entire GPA, a cumulative GPA for your student, from ninth grade up until that first semester of senior year. And that's what will determine what they wear at graduation, what color of a cord, what color of a tassel. So what affects GPA is basically all the classes except for the physical education ones. So does it include quarters or only semester grades? So it's only the semester grades. So the end of our semester for first semester is end of January, and then the end of second semester is mid-June, early June. So that'll be what goes onto the transcript and part of the GPA. Quarter grades are just more of an FYI, so you and your student know where they stand at the middle of the semester. Thank you for your positive comments. I'm glad the information was helpful. Okay, if there are no more questions, I will go ahead and end our meeting. Thank you again for all of your time and your support to our counseling department. Have a good evening.